When I started studying physics 15 years ago, everyone wants to become a professor in the end. Maybe someone recognizes a pattern here, what I'm telling you. Yesterday, it was the wrong text, but today it is the right text. So, I started studying physics, and as everyone who starts to study physics wants to become a professor. But for me, there was one question, yeah. Who studied physics with Michael Feind somehow? One, two, over there? Three, okay, just three. Four, okay, so four, yeah. For me it stopped that I wanted to become a professor roughly around 2006, 2007. And that was because I found out there's a really, really nice lecture by Michael Feind called Data Analysis. Back then, there was no data science. The term wasn't even created back then. So it was called Data Analysis, and it was done just for physics. But we learned a lot of stuff. So what is a single value decomposition? What is a PCM? What is regularization? What is a neural network? Things like this, and we also did some hands-on tutorials with real data. So at the same time, I also visited some lectures from computer science, machine learning. It was quite different. It was more the theoretical part, but in physics with Michael Feind, it was really the hands-on part, so we really cracked all the shit. I'm really happy that he's now here to share with me my experience. So now I am a data scientist in the company he founded. So welcome with me, Professor Dr. Michael Feind.
Okay, thank you very much. Where is my... Okay, thank you very much. So it is only four. I thought it could be more even, but I'm very proud of those. Actually, there sitting my first diploma student when I became professor here in Karlsruhe exactly 20 years ago. So the bad thing is we notice we are getting older. Okay, so let me talk a bit about artificial intelligence and differentiate a little bit between hype and real value. So to make one thing very clear, there is huge real value. This I can say just beforehand. Right. So yes, I am professor for physics here at the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology. For the time being, I don't have to teach for 4 years altogether. I also get no money from it, but I still have my research groups there. And I'm founder and chief scientist of the company Blue Yonder, and in the talks, a few of these examples are from Blue Yonder. Okay, so let's start. In my history is really elementary particle physics, and I started there in 83 already, worked in all the big particle colliders of the world, DESY in Hamburg, CERN in Switzerland, the largest one, Fermilab in the USA, and KEK in Japan. There are a few more, but these are really the most of the big ones, and which are still working and are very successful. And there one thing one learns there is to handle big data. So we did big data long before the term big data was coined. So nowadays, actually, data collection rate is about petabytes per second. And of course, you cannot store so much, so this has to be handled online to be reduced drastically by factors of 1 to 10 million in the first round already. And I show you one example later. And then, of course, the elementary particle physics is about... So we have tons of raw data, and it's all about getting real insights from it, knowledge. So, yeah, measuring quantities, detecting new effects, detecting new particles. And they have to be really statistically relevant. They have to be extracted from tons of noise, of uninteresting things, and to find a new effect, one has to be to try to suppress the background as much as possible, to enhance the signal as much as possible, and then we have to decide, is it statistically significant or not? Is it a real effect, an expected effect, or a not yet expected effect, or not? And the one thing which is very important there is, and that is extremely good training, so if you are too modest, then you will never discover anything new. Right, so if you are too shy to believe that what you find there is really a new effect, if you believe in it. But on the other hand, if you push out a result and claim a new discovery, then of course the whole professional world will jump on it and try to prove you wrong. Right? And they prove you wrong if it's wrong in half a year or so. That's also not so good for your career. It's for sure not good for your career. Okay, so that is really the thing, and that's all about machine learning, and what one does now in artificial intelligence is to find the right measure, the right compromise. Do I believe it? Is it a real effect or not? Right. So if you're, as I said, so if you're always too careful, then you never ever detect something new. Always the others are first. That's not good. Right? Okay. So we had. That means I have lots of experience and always had to build large teams around me with mainly students, so young, motivated, and very intelligent and engaged people who had really too fun to work with. Right? And so, the whole field was over really many, many years very, very traditional. So whatever was done, the mathematics then behind it was usually trivial. So one just said one made selections, right, by cutting away areas of the phase space and just keeping a small hyper a cube and to enhance signal and to bring back or to reduce background. So that was how almost everybody worked. And then we started, actually it was about 92 or so, or 93, I used my first neural network. So quite a long time ago. It was unclear, if there are correlations and so on, then a pure cut-based analysis, as everybody did at the time, was not the best thing. And then really a large part of my life was fighting for for better mathematical methods, even in high energy physics, a field where you think everything is very at the most modern and most technological edge. But it's not. It was a fight for years, and some of the people here know it, how we had to fight to bring our methods really to work, that finally the whole collaboration, this is always collaborative work with now up to 3,000 physicists in one collaboration at CERN, and finally everybody must agree to a publication. And so in this in these collaborations, there were, as I said, lots of fight, and so usually people are very, very reluctant to use new technology. But all this was finally very good, because now I do the same thing out in economy, and there it's even much, much worse. So I will tell you a bit of how decision-making works there. Okay, nowadays there's a hype, because many of these things that we had known under different names for a long time already are now called artificial intelligence, right? And I try to show you a bit how this belongs together. Okay. So, I start with what is the definition of intelligence? Intelligence. I like that. Actually, it's also a physicist, Max Tegmark, a very new definition. Intelligence is the ability to achieve complex goals. Right, and this subsumes the definition from the Oxford Dictionary, which tells us intelligence is the ability to acquire and apply knowledge and skills. So this is right, that is even more general, right? And I think that's a good definition. And artificial intelligence is all intelligence that is not biological, not made or built from our brains. So this is also from a book from Tegmark, his definition of life. That's also quite interesting. So life is a process that retains its complexity and replicates. Right, and of course, what we usually consider as life is biological life, like plants and animals. Here, the hardware and software evolved over millions of years. It took a very long time, very long time constants. Actually, the DNA, which is the main storage there from one generation to the other, has about 1.2 gigabyte information only. That's not very much, right? But of course, that developed also and made humans, right? So all also how our brain is in principle working is also stored in there. But then, because of the evolution of the big brain of the humans, then mankind built something that we call cultural life. And cultural lives, still the hardware is us, is still biological evolution, but the software not. Right? The software is designed now. So cultural life designs much of its software, and the software is stored in our big brain. So the human brain, there's an estimate that there's about 100 terabyte of storage in there. So it's by far more than DNA. And here the evolution time is now centuries to decades. So much, much, much faster than biological life. Right? If you just think about what mankind did in the last 100 years or 200 years compared to all the million years before, then it's completely clear. Essentially, everything happened in the last 100 years. And so why is it so fast? Because there's acceleration through teaching, right? And institutions, schools, universities, and so on, books, and technology. So not everybody has to learn everything himself again. Right? So if now you learn about special relativity, Einstein had to invent it. Right? Now you learn it at in a basic university course, and if you don't do it, you fail your exam. Right? So you have to, you know it, you can do it. Then, right? And now comes life 3.0, that's technological life. And there's where probably will go. So technological life designs its hardware and software. Right, software is already also the human now, the cultural is also designed, but in technological life also the hardware is now the worst or least efficient part of us. So this, there will be an intelligence explosion through technology. There will be something that is called singularity. We don't know exactly when, but maybe in 50 years or so, then a computer will have so much power, simply computing power and storage power and algorithmic power, that a computer will be better than a human in almost everything. Right? And at that time, life will change a lot. What you already have now, the tendency that also we do not just accept our bodies as they are, right? So we can already now, especially for disabled and so on, help them that they can better see, hear, walk and stuff like this, look nicer. And these things also with time become more and more socially accepted, and people want it. Right? People want it, so it will come. So it's only a question of time until we have a memory booster. It will come, I'm 100% sure, it will come. Right? Whether I like it, it's a different question, but it will come. Right? And finally, also, we will probably develop to cyborgs or robots. So most experts even think that that our consciousness will be that also no first that also computers get consciousness, and it might also be possible that we can transfer our consciousness to silicon somewhere or to technology at some stage. It might be possible. So most experts think that this will happen. Right. So we are nothing special, so the main story line here is. Very long time lags, right? Evolution, slow evolution, much, much, much accelerated evolution, extremely accelerated evolution. Okay, now, what makes machines intelligent? And in my view, there are two main branches in artificial intelligence. The first one is what I call brute force silicon. That is really Moore's law helps us here, right? So that the computing power and storage capacity doubles every, whatever, 18 months or so. Exponential growth now for many years. This is really fantastic. And now we simply can do things that were not possible 10 or 20 years ago. They were simply not possible. Right, and I show you some examples there. And what now and why we have this enormous hype now about artificial intelligence is that now things that the human can do well, but the computers up to now could not do well. Not there we always thought that's, we are the greatest. Right? So for us, it's easy to recognize objects on in an image in our eyes. Right? Or I can understand text, I can translate text. And all these things were very difficult for computers to do up to very recently, until neural networks could also learn these things. So that is brute force silicon. I show in the next transparency, next slide. And the other thing, and that is also where I like to work more on, is that is intelligent algorithms in the sense that not only computing power, but a combination of our neural networks, which still are very good, right, and much, much larger and better than the artificial neural networks. So with our knowledge of problems, our domain knowledge for concrete problem settings, but optimizing our ansatzes and adapted by machine learning on the basis of observed or simulated data. So, and also there a bit later about. So this is just one example of a program that actually was Google invested more than $1 billion just into CPU time for training a neural network that can recognize objects and images. Right, the input is difficult. Right, it's just pixels, few million pixels with colors in it. That's it. Right, and all the meaning just comes from really correlating neighboring pixels and so on. So that was something that up to a few years ago was impossible. Now it's done, it's solved, right? And now it starts, look, do you know whether this is a leopard or jaguar and so on? Now it starts that the machine can do it better than humans. But as I said, one still has to invest a lot in order to do it. Another example that was went through the past last year was the Japanese game Go. Go was also considered as an example that is extremely difficult for machines because chess is absolutely trivial compared to Go when one compares a number of possibilities. Right here, the number of possible situations is by far, 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 far larger than the number of atoms in the universe. So there's no possibility at all to try to calculate all possibilities and to learn from that. So the neural network that actually now 1.5 year bet the world champion does not try to evolve or to calculate all the possible possibilities of the future, but it develops a sort of gut feeling. It's not understandable for people how it does it. It's exactly like the grandmasters. They just learn from experience, and then somehow they simply know. You might also know it. Sometimes you know or you have a feeling. No, we have to do it like this, not like this. If you ask me why, I don't know, but I'm convinced it is like that. Right? So it's true that the neural networks also work like this now. Right? Actually, the company that built this program was on board by Google and developed it further. Now, not a single game can be won by any human anymore against the program. And they also reprogrammed it completely from scratch. In the first program, they put in lots of human expertise at the beginning. Also, then the world champion helped them to make it even better. Now they reprogrammed it again from scratch, and it only learned, interesting thing, by playing against itself. Right? But this is, of course, also relatively easy because the rules are fixed. Right? Of course, the rules are fixed, and that's the easy part in it, but the number of possibilities is so enormously huge. Okay, now one decides between, when I talked about cyborgs and so on, and singularity, that is that the aim of artificial intelligence research is that one wants to programs be like a human. So that's called general artificial intelligence. That one can solve all the problems, that they can be creative, they themselves choose what problems to solve and so on. We are still very far away from that, right? But there's also something that is called narrow AI, that means AI for special tasks, for very limited special tasks. And there are quite a few examples now where narrow AI is better than the average human or than the best human. And this is an example there, as I said, image recognition, face recognition, programs can do it better than humans. And translation starts to be extremely good, and text to speech and so on back. It took some time, but now there's really good progress. Then games, I talked about chess and Go. Then Jeopardy was in between. Very funny, I think, are these Atari video games. So there are now programs that learn just from having the screen there and the controller. So the screen is really the screen, right? The pixels, and the controller is, I don't know, four or so buttons that can be that have to be steered. And there's now one program that is already better than the humans in over 50 different Atari games, right? So it just learns from really playing the game. Nothing else. So like also a small kid would try to, and then by observing, I get more points if I do this and that. And there's one program which is very good in car racing and in, I don't know how all these games are called, but in very different games. And it learned it also by just doing it, right? Reinforcement learning is the important word behind it. Space invaders, breakout, stuff like this. Yeah, then I talk a bit about our own work, elementary particle physics research. So we used lots of neural networks and so on for that. And we also, I say it later. And now what the company does is retail business management, automating, improving supply chain pricing and so on for retail business. So in the, I don't want now to talk about this elusive future artificial general intelligence, but the narrow intelligence where we are already better, as good as humans for automation, or better than humans for improvement and automations. Now these are also two key words that one very often hears, predictive analytics and prescriptive analytics. I want to define them. And nowadays both are disciplines of machine learning, and machine learning is nowadays, in the jargon, this changes all the time, a subdiscipline of artificial intelligence, right? And not everything was just invented in the last year or so, right? Most of the stuff is evolutionary. Okay, yeah, Blue Yonder, what we are doing in our company is digital innovation and disruption from Germany. I think that is also important. Since I'm working in many international collaborations, I know that our education and knowledge and so in Germany is very good. Where we are not very good in is in selling this and making good market products out of it. Then Germany is very bad compared to the US, for example. But from the technology point of view, there's no reason that we have to hide. So we have lots of innovation prizes, and I'm very proud to have been named by the Technology Review in a list of the 50 most innovative companies of the world. So next point I want to show, and that's also something we do a lot now in Blue Yonder, is decisions under uncertainty. Okay, most important personal and professional decisions are done by gut feeling. They are done emotionally. We do not think about it very much. And also, these decisions cannot, thank God, not be automated. So these are, for example, all once-in-a-lifetime decisions. Should I marry this woman, for example? This is an artificial intelligence will not yeah, we have to do it. We have to do this decision. This will always be human, and it will not be automated. But operational decisions, e.g., in for example, in a retail business, they can be automated and data-driven by artificial intelligence by more than 99%. So I'm claiming, we are claiming that more than 99% of all business decisions in almost all industries, not only retail, but in retail it works already, can be automated. What kind of decisions are these? These are decisions that come again and again in a similar form. For example, if you're a retailer, what products do I have to order now? What is the right price for my product? Who from my long list of customers should get this expensive catalog? And I didn't do it not only once, but I have to reorder every day, for example, and, or I have to send out catalogs once a month or once a season. And that is what really happens in reality. Right? If you're an employee, just a normal employee in a normal industry, and then you get another question, or you have the task to decide, so what are you doing? If there's a request, and this is the truth, about 90% is do nothing. Do nothing also comprises do the same as always. Right? For example, like yesterday, or like last year. And if one, I look into so many decisions in many industries now, and it's, you don't believe how bad these decisions are taken. That's really true. It's not a joke. So then the better version is follow some business rules. Right? About 10% or 9%. And that really somebody now sits down and thinks is almost negligible. Right? How many apples should I order now? They are really looking nice. And but Aldi now has a promotion of all apples. Hmm. Then the weather is, how many do you think do really think like that? And there's also a good reason why they cannot, right? There are many good reasons. One is they have to do too many of these such decisions. So you have to know how the human brain works. We have a two-step decision system. One is a fast intuitive one, the gut feeling one. And the second is this slow rational one. And so animals also have one, but not two, most animals. Human decision making has lots of biases. And that is because we almost use only our system one, the fast one. And the fast system cannot understand statistics, for example. It cannot calculate. It just knows yes, no, more or less. Right? But it is proven that even experts, especially experts, also, it includes me, right, very often draw the wrong conclusions to the wrong decisions just because we have lots of biases. All the biases were very useful in evolution, right? So we survived because we have these biases that we do not decide rationally, but we decide okay, if there comes a tiger, I have either to fight or to run, but not think, is this tiger dangerous? And there's a good reason for this, why there are all these biases. Another famous bias is the so-called IKEA effect. And that is, if we ourselves help just a tiny little bit in the production of something, of a hardware, then we have the feeling that it's way more valuable. Way more worth, only because we just drew a few screws, right? So then people are extremely unhappy when they notice if they want to sell it on eBay that people don't want to pay for it. But it's of course only you yourself who thinks it's more valuable. Right? So and there are tons of these biases. And for example, Nobel Prize winner Daniel Kahneman has written a nice book about all this. And so that's very well understood, but not known by everybody. So this is how modern decision making should be done. It should be based on objective data. Right? You should try to make predictions of the near future. What will happen? You have to, I come to that in a minute. then you have to know what is your cost or utility if the future deviates from your best prediction, upwards or downwards. Right? Then you have to optimize. You have to make a decision of, for example, how many to order now. And then you have to optimize, and you optimize that the expected value of the utility is optimal given the predictions. Right? And if you do that for many things, then you automate the whole thing. So this is a very, very easy recipe, but that is not done very often. So when can one use predictive analytics? That's also a very important, and the physicist knows lots about. So most people actually think that the world think that the world is quite deterministic, that essentially everything can be calculated or is predetermined. That's wrong. Physicists know it's wrong already because of quantum mechanics, but it's also wrong for a much more mundane thing, namely so-called deterministic chaos. So there, a physicist can tell you what will happen in this pendulum, can exactly calculate it, right? But this system there is only slightly more complicated. It's just the drawing of the lottery numbers. And there you can even prove that you cannot predict for the next drawing which numbers will be drawn. And that is because there are so many so-called branching points where it's enough to have 1 nanometer difference in the initial conditions, but the final result is completely different. And for example, if I let a ball fall here, then it can either go just next to the edge, then it will go that direction, or if it's just half a micrometer more left, then it will touch the edge here, and then will go completely differently. Right? And if you have many such branching, and usually 2 or 3 is enough, then you cannot, there's no chance anymore to calculate what will come out. So that's one of the reasons why even quite simple systems are not predictable. Right? And now, coming back to our example, if you want to predict how many of these apples will be sold tomorrow, almost everything in the world is somewhere in between. So of course you can say something about it, but you for sure you cannot prove, you can never say it will be exactly 262. This will almost always be wrong. Right? So almost everything in life is somewhere, there is some predictability, but there's also lots of unpredictability or randomness inside. Right? And if you want to do such a prediction, then what we for example do then is to try to get data for as many as possible influencing factors like prices, promotions, local competitors, seasonality, holidays, days of the week, brand, weather forecast. All these here might be in principle influencing factors to that you can use to predict how many of these apples will be sold. And then that's the important point. And then, of course, you do not only have data from one store, one product, one day, but we have many items, many stores, and many days. So you need lots of statistics. Right? So you have all these statistics, so this here might be very fastly billions of lines. If you want, it's in a matrix, it's rows. Right? Billions of rows. And for each row, you can build lots of variables, namely all these here and everything, right, that is known up to that point in time, not afterwards. Right? So you have to make a causal model, of course. And then you can try, a machine learning algorithm can make the mapping from the input, this is all I know today, and the output that was measured, the number of apples that were sold the next day. And the result is then a so-called forecast or prediction. And so in standard or legacy approaches, this is a number. For example, in a normal ERP system, this is essentially all the companies in the world have. This is one word is reserved for a prediction. It's a number, one number. But that's not the truth. So that is what I call a prediction. namely for each of the possible futures, selling 0, 1, 2, 300, 200, 1,000, for each of the possible futures, we want to know what the probability that this will come out. As I said, it's not 100% predictable, so we can never make a good point estimation. It makes no sense. This is a prediction. A prediction is a complete probability distribution. And if you have that, then you can do the complete risk management and also a good decision. This contains all the information that one can know at that time. Especially in particular, you have quantiles like that point, you know, in only 5% of the cases, less will be sold, or in only 5% of the cases, more will be sold, right? So, and this is very important to know if you want to make optimal decisions. Okay, these are the results of next week Bundesliga games. Of course, they are not the results. These are the predictions. And again, what you can say now is only probabilities. Right? So, and you see something. So usually the home team has a higher probability. That's for a draw, the white one, and that's for the guest team. Okay, an exception there now is Borussia Dortmund against Hannover 96. But even Bayern Munich, what is this? They play again already? Didn't they play?
Yeah, they did.
Yes. Ah, okay, so I didn't notice it. They play again. That was a cup. Yes. Actually, I even saw it. Okay, so that is also predictive analytics. Right? You cannot say for sure what will happen, but you can give probabilities. Okay, now prescriptive analytics. Prescriptive analytics means you cannot give to a retailer a probability density. What should he do? He wants to know, do I have to order 0 or 10 or 20? Tell me this, right? So he wants to have recipes. And prescriptive analytics now exactly does this. You have to know what is your utility function, what does it cost, right? If, for example, you decide now to order so and so many, but in reality, there's much more demand or there's much less demand. So on one side, there's lost sales and customer dissatisfaction if you don't have enough, right? On the other hand, if you order way too much, especially if it's perishable food, like sushi or ground beef, that's what we're all doing in the company, then, of course, lots of this has to be thrown away, right? And it's really waste. And that's also not what you want, right? For sure not. Okay, so you want to have the optimal decision. And that is done by prescriptive analytics. Now, this is also important for a normal supermarket chain has maybe 20,000 different articles in the store, maybe 500 stores, and maybe you have done lots of days. I mean, 200 so-and-so, or 300 in a year, opening days, and you want to do it for many years, so you have lots of recipes. And so what you then certainly do, and that's also one of the reasons why people usually don't do it, they have to do it every day, right? So you should automate it, because otherwise it will not work. I show you that. Now, this is important. And a decision under uncertainty is always a compromise, right? For example, you are either out of stock. If you do not, if you don't order enough, then you have a high out of stock rate. If you order too many, you have high write-offs, right? And every decision under uncertainty is always a compromise. So, and you can do. Go to this point, right, or to that point, or to that point. That is a decision that that you have, right? So this is what I call the global strategy. That's a human decision. So the CEO or someone has to say, we want to be there, right? But now, what happens if one uses such an AI system is that you can improve write-offs and out-of-stock simultaneously. And that is coming because the global decision, the global strategy parameter is now broken down to 20 million decisions a day that all try to coherently to optimize the same strategy. Right? And by that, you come from one curve to a more efficient curve. And that can be quite a difference. Huge improvement, yeah. Now, this is also interesting. So what we very often observe is, yeah, you do predictive, prescriptive, you send them recipes. Right? And then the disponent is sitting there, and he has a screen, and that tells order 8. But he is allowed to do what he wants. And he's not a bad guy. Right? He wants to make the best thing, but then he says, ah, no, but my feeling tells me, no, this is, I have to order more, and I have to order less. Right? My feeling tells me that. And so they usually try to optimize a little bit. Right? And other things that we also have seen, for example, really clever ones, they said, yeah, but last year, the Blue Yonder algorithm has overestimated this a little bit. So I'm very clever now. I'm reducing this now by 10%. But of course, a machine learning system also has learned from last year. So that also, so it's wrong to do it like that. Right? So often there's a goodwill. Right? I want to make it better, and compared to a static system, it would have been better, but for a learning system, it's of course worse. Right? And okay, so that's happened here. That was a German supermarket chain. The out-of-stock rate was about 7.5%. Then when they got the predictions, the recipes, it went down to about 5%. And at that day, then the CEO said, okay, I believe it works. Now let's try to do it full automatically. And you see what happened. This is elimination of human bias. Right? So it can be huge. Of course, it's difficult to say, right? Because this is a system where artificial intelligence is better than the best humans. But tell it a human, right? Do you want to hear it? There's a computer program that is better than you with your 20 years of experience. Not so easy. Eh? Okay, I tell you simply what you can achieve with artificial intelligence is that you can gain in many different KPIs, key performance indicators, simultaneously, that usually, by just global decisions, it's always, if you improve one, you worsen the other. So that is what we achieve there. 99% automation, so essentially it's completely full automatic. It's only if there are something very special cases where they know something that the computer program cannot know that people have to do something manually. Less write-offs, less waste, more freshness. That means the number of days when you just pick an article in a supermarket, the number of days that it's still valid is longer if you do it like that on average compared to if you don't do it. Less capital binding, less out of stock, more turnover, more efficiency. So, everything nice. Okay, I don't want to bore you about this, but this is also interesting. Then we are always asked, yeah, but this destroys jobs. This is very, very bad, right? And people don't want it. This is an example, Morrisons, where we do some such automatic supply chain optimization. Number 4 grocery supermarket in the UK. And actually, they really love it. They like it. Also, the store managers and people in the stores like it. Because up to now, they had to come in extremely early in the morning and sit 2 or 3 hours in front of a screen and say, yes, order this. So this is just stopped. Right. Then they had a back storage which was completely crowded, and all the day people had to bring stuff from there into shelves and back. There was lots of work that was simply not good. And now what they didn't is they didn't fire these people. No, they are now there for the customers. They are there for answering questions. They are there for that it looks nice and tidy. And so that's an absolutely positive side effects, right? And so morale is really high in the store, for example. And there was some mystery shopping that was in one. They were always bad in these. Now they are extremely good. And the end customer satisfaction also very good. This even has consequences. This is the stock price of Morrisons in the last 2 years. So actually, that was when we started to work with them. They also made other good decisions, right? I don't want to claim that's only due to this here, but it is. And if you see, this is really a very huge thing. In yellow, you see the UK retail stock index, so right, the average of all retailers in the UK compared to Morrisons. Morrisons plus 50%, overall minus 20%. And so even then, CEOs and CFOs, so people who are not technical at all, right, make statements then in their results press conferences about what things are good, and they then say that this was essentially, or the single largest change was exactly the automation of the supply chain. Okay, and for that we also just got a prize 2 weeks ago. For Kaufland, we also do it. We do it for meat, not for fresh meat. And there it goes even then just up the supply chain, up to production. And that is also, it also has really consequences, because now they have the most modern meat factory in Europe, and that was only possible due to that, because there we make even predictions of what the single stores will order tomorrow and the day after and so on. And now it goes really, so more cattle survives due to that, right? And there's quite a number, quite a large number of less meat that has to be thrown away at the end of the lifetime, right? So this is of course what one wants. Yeah, another thing that we are doing for Otto, distance seller, is predictive shipping on an online marketplace. So if you go to Otto.de, then you find there many, many articles which, similar to Amazon, they are not sold by them, they are only pushed through their systems, and finally you buy them directly at Tommy Hilfiger or whatever it is. And but then the process always was that Tommy Hilfiger sends it to Otto, then they repackage it, and then they send it to the end customer. This took 5 to 7 days, not good. And what we are doing now is also to predict what will the customers probably order tomorrow, in 2 days, in 3 days, and so on. And then Otto buys it already from Tommy Hilfiger and so on, from over 3,000 different companies, so that they are then just coming in time when the real order from the end customer comes. And that also works very well. The mean delivery time for these articles is now 1 to 2 days, so much, much less. And with that, it is competitive with Amazon. Nobody accepts today 7 days anymore. So that brought a huge turnover increasement. Large customer satisfaction, also important. Way less returns. So for all the distance selling, returns is a huge problem. So the return rates on average are higher than 50%. So all the articles that are sold online, more than 50% is sent back. So if you just calculate how much CO2 this is, it's really a shit, right? but that was also interesting for us and not expected. So if you send the articles fast, right, then the return rate, so you people accept it way more and send it back much less. So much less storage needed, and less deliveries per order. Right? Because if everything is there already, then also if you order 10 articles, they are in one packet, not in three that are sent to you in consecutive days. Okay, also price is an interesting thing. Right? The effect of price on demand is of course, it's very important. And if you want to do something like that, then you have to do machine learning, which does, where the output is more or less a complete function or functional, not only a number, for example, how is the demand, will the demand develop as a function of a relative price change, right? So it can be, you need at least two parameters for it, right? So demand at reference price and the slope at the reference price, and for larger changes you also have to make more assumptions about how it develops further, right? And you want to have one such thing again, individually for every article, every day, yeah, or every time period that you dare to change prices. And so we're doing also for Otto, for example, and other companies, pricing again with more than 99% automation. And the results are again really great. So more market share, more turnover, more raw profit, more customers, also more new customers. New customers for sure not due to too high prices. Right? So pricing does not mean it's always it's against customers. It must be the right price at the right time. Right? It's more against the competitors. Right? And every retailer wants to keep his customers, so nobody can dare to price against their end customers. Also less returns, zero complaints, that was that is always monitored very strictly. And this is also very important, way less rest at the end of the season. So one does not do it nowadays anymore, that price is constant over the whole season, and shortly before, then, for example, for end of the summer season, it's minus 70% or so. So essentially worthless, but one does it more gradually, and there is a function then of the price sensitivity of customers, but also of how much do I still have, how much do I think will be sold anyway with this price, right? So it's a way, way more complex mathematics, and the but this is again is good for everybody. By the way, there are even investigations of the from the German government that this sort of dynamic pricing is good for everybody. It's not it's because it optimizes what you want. It optimizes really that the number of articles which are exchanged, so it can be bought. So people can buy better if it's done like that compared and also earlier, not only at the end of the season, compared to the old way. So I think that this year will become very important. That is also what Blue Yonder does now for retail is what we call a vertical end-to-end AI solution. So for special problems, for special tasks that many companies have and where AI methods, data-driven AI methods can bring a huge value. Applications are built that are easy to use and where the complexity, mathematical complexity and so on is hidden. It should be used as I use here my iPhone or my phone without having to know what's inside. Right? I don't have to understand all the technical details inside, but I can use it. Right? And I think for these AI solutions, it also has to be come like that, that people who are not data scientists have to be able to work with it. Right? And of course, the data science is in there, of course. So, and yeah, and okay. So high company provide as a service in the cloud, and we say this is an intelligence layer on top of existing ERP systems, on top of anything. You need, of course, you need the data somewhere, right? And okay, nowadays, of course, this is a service in the cloud, and you have to load in historical data once at the beginning, and then only every day the new sales and price data and so on, and you get back directly the decisions that are then automatically executed in the ERP system. Okay. How long do I still have? Until 10? Okay, let me make some more remarks, just shortly, different things. So one thing that is also very important is causality is not correlation, right? And for example, the gentleman has said, for every complex problem, there's an answer that is clear, simple, and wrong. And this is something that you can, because the last one is not so much known, but many, many people and decisions in are taken in a way that it is clear and simple. But if it's wrong, then it's of course not good, right? And one such thing is actually in marketing. So there very often numbers are completely wrongly interpreted. I don't want to go into detail, and just the important thing is this one here. So very often one has historic data on a customer. The target is that he buys something that one wants to optimize, and you can decide on an action, for example, to send a catalog or to send a coupon or something like that, right? And so what very often happens is that with time, the causal effects are like this here. So the historic data on the customer somehow determine about the action policy, right? So usually it's not random. The historic data on the customer also have an influence on whether the customer buys in the next period, then let's say next month or not, right? And of course, then this is what you really want to know is this red arrow. What is the influence of the action? How do I influence him in changing his behavior? That is what you really want. That's why you do marketing and PR and stuff like this and price actions and so on. Right? But now the problem is that very often this green arrow more or less approximates already the blue one, right? Because the good customers, they get all the stuff, the bad customers not. But the good customers, very probably, because there's autocorrelation, they like the brand, they like the product, they have money, right? So they would buy anyway, they don't need the stuff. So. So that's exactly the point. So we have seen that there are systems on the market which were sold for more than €1 million, and we found out that the causal effect was exactly as large as if you throw a dice. It was zero. And why is it? That's because of that, right? Because people see a correlation, but they don't know what is the causal structure, what is the causal effect. So do customers buy because they received a catalog, or do customers get a catalog because they usually buy? Right? So that's the point. And so marketers have to be data scientists, not only creative. They should also be creative, no question. Yeah? But if one has to really make a decision who should get this and who not, right, then the real target is the red arrow, and usually it's not. People are not even aware of this effect. Okay, we are in a Python conference, so I have long history. I learned programming actually still with punched cards, right? And my first language was Fortran. I still love it. We made a transition then. Some of the people here know that. Also, the complete elementary particle physics community in the whole world made a transition from Fortran to C++, and I estimated it once, I forgot it actually. I thought this transition costed the taxpayer at least 10,000 man years. Really, that was a hard decision. It led to the fact that at that time, lots of stuff that was written for years, libraries were thrown away. The new libraries were not yet good enough. And much worse, all the Fortran programmers had to learn a new language. And so what happened then, in the morning they had courses about object-oriented design, and in the afternoon they applied it without seeing where it's useful, where it's not useful. So that was chaotic, absolute chaotic. As I said, I think this costed really the taxpayer a lot of money. And I always had large research teams. And for me, C++ was so complicated that I could not program myself anymore because I had to organize so many things and so on. You have other obligations then, and it was too complicated. And what we then really found out is that from an idea to at least to a test, this time took awful long. And about 5 or 6 years ago, we in the company decided to move to Python. Also, high energy physics in the whole world, again, gradually goes more and more into Python again. and what it means again. Go into Python. At the very first, we were afraid: is it fast enough? Right. So as a scripting language, but then we discovered, of course, Heisen, and we saw that many of the libraries, anyhow, were okay. Right. NumPy and so on. What I love most about Python is this simple syntax. I think this is so important, right? That you simply can, from an idea that you have. I mean, since we use Python, I do personally, although I have tons of obligations, I program again. And I think this is enormously important, really enormously important. Speed of code production and of for sure for first versions, but also for the running program then, has accelerated enormously since the introduction of Python. So I love NumPy, Pandas, scikit-learn et al. I love Dask. I personally, is the speaker still here from yesterday? I personally think that Dask is really very important for the future of Python, because we have to be out of court nowadays. Right? It's not enough to have only algorithms in one core. We have to have distributed algorithms on huge data sets, especially also for complicated tasks in artificial intelligence. And I think this is a very important thing that I personally love very much. Okay, yeah, only one word to that, ups and downs of neural networks. So when I was a long time in the game, and as I said, I used my first neural network in 93 about, and we had lots of successes. We had to fight a long time, but also then in the machine learning community, or in the multivariate analysis community, as it was called at that time, then also, yeah, there were more and more complaints, and people didn't like neural networks anymore, and one had to do other things. We also did lots of other things. But we also tried to more or less keep these strategy of neural networks, but made them much, much faster by pre-processing and so on. And so we have heard neural networks are dead, and the last few years have told us the complete difference, right? So, So also in there you see that there are movements that and very strict statements by experts, which then turn out to be wrong later. Okay, I mean, these were neural networks as we started, three layers. I remember when we tried to train the first four-layer network. Actually, we had one in production in one of the experiments there. It made it a bit better than a three-layer network. But at that time, this was still on alpha deck stations. The training was like that. So we submitted, we pressed on the cursor, went away. And after 2 weeks, it was there again. And in between, we had no output. Didn't know what the thing did. But the result was good. But okay, of course, there happened a lot. But in a system, I mean, in physics code, I think we have there at least 100 neural networks, no, much more, that my team was engaged in, or has written, has trained. And and most of them were only three layers because nothing else was possible at that time. Moore's law, of course, helped us. Nowadays, networks look like that. There happened, of course, a lot, but not so much. Still, neural network training is still finding a local minimum in a very high-dimensional space, and it's lots of gut feeling and so on. You can never prove whether you have the best solution. You can, again, do it with brute force by just trying many, many starting values and many different hyperparameters, many different architectures, and so on. But of course, one important thing was a GPU, right? So our measurement was 16 times faster than 20 CPUs. One GPU is 16 times faster than 20 CPUs. Interesting, of course, TPUs, FPGAs. what happens there, so specialized hardware for this training. And of course, also synchronous and asynchronous data parallelization possible. That was always difficult in the old world. So I don't tell you that here anymore. No, I want to say this here. This is because I'm very proud of that. If you're a professor for many years and a researcher, and you have lots of PhD students, then you also can make a meta-analysis and you find what my PhD students do all the time, right? Where do they spend most of their time and effort? And then we found out for a Collider experiment in Japan that for about 3/4 of the analysis, you needed to reconstruct one of the B mesons completely. And then we found out built a hierarchical model with our human intelligence and found out that usually a research physicist needs 72 decisions in order to get to make the reconstruction optimal, right? And then we trained neural networks for all of these 72 tasks, and they were all better than human decisions. Right. And finally, it reconstructed then about 1,100 different reactions, whereas usually a PhD student does 1, 2, or 3 reactions. So this corresponded then to about 500 normal PhD theses. Right. One PhD thesis equals 500 normal PhD theses. So and what came out was that it was about a factor of 2 better efficiency relative to all analyses that have been performed during 10 years by all 450 physicists of the collaboration, including myself. So it was 2 times better efficiency at same purity, or about 10 times better purity at same efficiency. That's the plot there. And so this data taking of 10 years costed 700 million euros. So the value of this by just doubling it is, of course, it's play money. Nobody pays it to you, right? But the value is, we could also have achieved the same by running the experiment another 10 years, right? So the cost would have been 700 million euros. Now, for the successor experiment, also in my institute, we rewrote this program completely, made it even better. We rewrote it in Python. The other one was C++. And also, this is for the successor experiment, and there the events will be already completely reconstructed. They come out of the detector then. So now that was 10 years after the experiment started. Right? Now it will be done directly when the data is taken. It's directly fully reconstructed by artificial intelligence, and all the physicists can directly go to the meta level. Then they also wrote an interface that program, the new one, can also be run on the old data, right? And they pushed it through, and now it's a factor of 4 even. Not 2, but 4. 2.1 billion euros equivalent. Of course, the taxpayer has saved 2.1 billion euros. Of course, nobody would have accepted that money, right? Or given the money. Okay, so I think there is... many things to me. Okay, I think I'm over time. I just give you two things. Now what we are doing is operation research by AI, construction of discrimination, that's some R&D we are doing, the construction of discrimination-free estimators, so machine learning models where you can be sure that, for example, men are not discriminated from women, or races are not discriminated. Right? So everything is possible. Right? You can also, so AI is, and machine learning is a very sharp weapon. You can use it the good way or the bad way. So that's my claim. Also, society has to decide what we want to do, but we can do. And I think it's always better that you can do, that it's simply random what comes out. And I can tell you one thing, what happens now, for example, insurance and so on, is not discrimination-free. Then we build something for reinforcement learning to put also the environmental calculation into the GPU. So try to improve on OpenAI. And new applications of adversarial networks. Something I'm thinking right now about is AI-based marketing campaign planning. Very interesting, absolutely chaotic how it's done now. Yeah, or design of classification algorithms which guaranteed independence on specified variables. That is important for scientific applications here and there, where you want to measure also causal effects. So should we be afraid of artificial intelligence? Germans are, unfortunately. I think we should not be afraid. We have to do it. I mean, in economy, it's absolutely clear. So companies like Amazon and Google and so on, they use it, of course. Every decision is done there based on data and machine learning. And I think, for me, it's absolutely clear that no AI is no option. We have to use it. It will come. If we don't do it, somebody else will do it. It will come, absolutely, for sure. But I'm quite positive that it will also be for the good. Thank you very much.
Not yet. Ah, okay. So then, one short question.
Yep. Thank you very much for the talk. I think it was very enlightening. You mentioned in the early part of the conversation about consciousness, that machines yes. can be taught consciousness, but you alluded that experts believe. So could you expand on that a little bit?
Yeah. Actually, I don't know. Right? But I am also convinced that there's nothing special in the human brain. It is a very complex neural network. It does not work exactly the same way as the artificial ones now. But I am personally convinced that consciousness simply comes if it's only complex enough. And if there are, these are recurrent networks, right? So there's lots of things inside, happening inside. I do not believe that we need something hypernatural or whatever that is giving us this. It's simply the sum of everything that happens in our brain that is stored there, that all the influences that are there. At some stage of complexity, it will come. That is my personal belief, but there's no proof of that.